In the last video, we introduced the concept of enzymes, that is, the group of proteins that act as catalysts for chemical reactions. In other words, enzymes are agents that dramatically increase the rates of chemical reactions. Without enzymes, life could literally not exist because they allow the body and other organisms to control reactions that are occurring that enable metabolism. In this video, we focus on more details about how enzymes actually work to catalyze chemical reactions. The first thing that we need to explore is, in general, what is required for any chemical reaction to take place. In other words, regardless of whether the reaction is catalyzed by an enzyme, what are the prerequisites for chemical reactions? There are, in general, three conditions required for any chemical reaction to take place. The first condition is that if there's more than one reactant, those reactants have to collide with one another. In other words, if you have an acid on one side of the room and a base on the other side of the room, and they are physically separated, there will be no acid-base reaction regardless of how reactive that acid and that base are. They must come into contact in order to react, and that is true regardless of what reactants are present. So within the body, for example, it is essential if there are two molecules coming together, such as we are taking monosaccharides and linking them together to form polysaccharides, those monosaccharides have to come together, colliding, in order to possibly react. Collision by itself is not enough. Condition number two for a reaction to take place is that not only do the reactants have to collide, but they have to align properly. In other words, the correct functional groups have to come together in close proximity to one another so that the necessary bonds can be broken and formed. And this can be a very slow process in the absence of a catalyst. Then the third criteria is that when the reactants come together, there has to be a suitable activation energy for the reaction to take place. What is activation energy? Let's draw that out as a chart. In this chart, I will abbreviate activation energy as EA. The chart we can think of as a map of the progress of a chemical reaction. We call this a reaction coordinate. On the x-axis is the progress of the reaction. If this were a multi-step reaction, each step would have a specific progress plot that could go with it. On the y-axis is the overall energy. When we look at this, we start at the energy of the reactant or reactants. So I'm going to go ahead and plot that here, and I will label this as reactant or reactants. It could be single or plural depending upon the particular reaction. At the end of the pathway is the energy of the products of the chemical reaction. So I'm going to go ahead and put that over here as product. In this particular case, the energy of the reactant here is higher than the energy of the product here because it's higher up on that y-axis that represents energy. Therefore, we would describe this particular reaction shown here as an exothermic reaction because the energy of the reactant is greater than the energy of the product, meaning the net effect is that energy is lost from the system. The product is a lower energy product, a more stable product, in other words, than the reactant. So overall, this reaction, in this case, is favorable. If the scenario were flipped and going from the reactant to the product meant going to a higher energy where the product energy was up here somewhere where my laser pointer is, we would describe that reaction as being endothermic, where the energy of the reactant is lower than the energy of the product. Regardless of whether a reaction is endothermic or exothermic, this gap here in the middle will become the so-called activation energy, which is a relative energy maxima where the energy of the system goes up before it comes back down to whatever the energy of the product is. We measure activation energy as the difference between the energy of the reactant and this maximum point of the plot. I will label that here as EA for activation energy. And this is true regardless of how favorable the overall reaction is. Even if the energy of the product here was all the way down as low as it could possibly go, there would still be this activation energy here. That is the intrinsic energy required for the making and breaking of chemical bonds. No matter how favorable the overall process is, there's still an energetic barrier associated with that process of breaking up or coming together. Breaking up is hard to do. So, in order to overcome this activation energy, there has to be sufficient energy in the system available. in order for that process to take place. And this is a key requirement of any chemical reaction, is there has to be enough energy available for that activation energy to be met. Let's take a look at how enzymes are able to conquer these three conditions that have to be met for any reaction, and oftentimes in the absence of an enzyme, dramatically inhibit the ability of reactions to actually take place in normal environments. So how do enzymes make reactions more favorable? In other words, how do enzymes speed up dramatically the rate of chemical reactions? Well, they work at all three of the conditions required for any reaction to expedite each of those three conditions in being met. They facilitate the collision or interaction of reactants. They facilitate the proper alignment of reactants in order to react, and they dramatically lower the essential activation energy required for reactions to take place. There are a few different models that exist to explain how substrates, that is the reactants, interact with the enzyme, the catalyst, via its active site, the location where the substrate binds, in order for the conditions for any reaction to be dramatically enhanced, with facilitating the collision of the reactants, the alignment of the reactants to properly break and form bonds, and lowering the activation energy of the system. A common old school way of describing this was the lock and key model, where the enzyme active site was thought of as a lock that had a very rigid three-dimensional shape that had to be complementary to the exact shape of the substrate, the key, so that when the key, that is the substrate, came in, it would essentially unlock the active site for the chemical reaction to be catalyzed. More recently, the induced fit model that I will describe here and focus on in detail is what is the prevailing line of thought with regard to how enzymes are able to catalyze reactions. In the induced fit model, rather than the enzyme active site having a very rigid, very restrictive shape that doesn't change during the course of the process, instead that active site is somewhat dynamic, meaning that as the substrate comes to interact, the active site can fold around with bonds rotating just a bit in order to more tightly accommodate the substrate into the active site. Likewise, the substrate can also bend around a bit because carbon-carbon single bonds and other single bonds generally have some degree of rotation possible for them in order for that substrate to form a very tight interaction with the enzyme's active site. That very tight interaction is governed primarily by the different R groups that are present on amino acids. Remembering back to our unit on proteins, we talked about the 20 standard amino acids and how the R groups represent a variety of different functional groups, such as alcohols that are capable of hydrogen bonding, to alkyl groups that are capable of van der Waals interactions. And so when the substrate comes in and the active site somewhat accommodates to the shape of that substrate, the R groups interact with various features on the substrate to facilitate a strong intermolecular interaction between the substrate and the three-dimensional shape of the active site, where, for example, hydrogen bonding might occur between a serine residue, which has a hydroxy group, and a hydroxy group or an amino group present on the substrate to facilitate a strong intermolecular interaction. After that substrate has bound to the enzyme, and this is not a covalent bond, this is a variety of those types of intermolecular interactions, such as electrostatics and van der Waals and dipole-dipole and hydrogen bonding. The substrate binds, the enzyme changes shape slightly to best accommodate that substrate, as we mentioned. Then, with the substrate perfectly aligned for the reaction to take place, and as well, any cofactors, any other essential vitamins bound to the enzyme, or minerals, the molecule is perfectly aligned for a reaction to take place, such as taking the single molecule that is shown kind of in this orangish pink and breaking that covalent bond within the molecule to create two products here shown in yellow and blue, such as would be the case if we were taking a disaccharide, such as sucrose, and breaking it into its individual monosaccharides. And then at that point, once the product is formed, those products don't bind to the enzyme so well, and they are ultimately then released, leaving the active site and floating out into the cell or whatever environment this enzyme is present in. So as we think about how this induced fit model relates to enhancing the conditions required for any reaction, we see how the induced fit model will explain how we increase the collision of reactants, because if there are more than one reactant present, both of those reactants would come together at two separate spots of the active site, thereby allowing the reactants to collide. Not only does it allow them to collide, it also increases the rate at which they align properly with complementary functional groups for the making and breaking of bonds. And in fact, in cases of acid and base reactions, many enzymes have at their active site locations that are acidic or basic to properly align molecules so that they can be rapidly protonated or deprotonated to facilitate chemical reactions in taking place. And then the third criteria is by facilitating the collision of molecules, they're going to lower the activation energy of the system to facilitate the chemical reaction. By lowering the activation energy, we increase the rate of the overall chemical reaction. Here's an illustration of how that activation energy can be shown for a reaction that is catalyzed by an enzyme relative to one that is not. Here we see a reaction coordinate that is showing the progress of the reaction on the x-axis and the free energy of the system on the y-axis for two different reactions, one that is catalyzed by an enzyme and one that is not. In both cases, the reactants are the same. Here we have green and red reactants. Our product is the yellow compound shown here in our schematic. The reaction with the enzyme follows the path shown in blue. The reaction without the enzyme follows the path shown in orange or yellow here through what I'm tracing out here. What you will notice is that in a reaction with or without an enzyme, the energy of the reactants is the same in both cases because those reactants are just floating around in solution. Regardless of whether the enzyme is there, they have a certain energy, and hence the free energy of the system is the same regardless of whether the reaction will be catalyzed with an enzyme or not. Where the magic happens is once the reactants bind to the enzyme's active site, and that active site properly aligns the molecules to take place and facilitates their collision, that's going to lower the activation energy, the energy required to make and break chemical bonds here, relative to having no enzyme possible. So this energy maximum point of the curve is a lot higher without the enzyme than it is with the enzyme. By lowering that activation energy, we dramatically increase the rate of the reaction by lowering that energetic barrier, and that allows the products to form effectively faster. You'll notice at the end of the pipeline here, the product, the total energy of the product, since the product is the product and it's the same product regardless of whether there's an enzyme or not, you will notice the product energy is not affected by the presence or absence of the enzyme. And hence, since the reactant energy and the product energy aren't affected by the enzyme, the total energy change in the system we represent as delta G is not going to be impacted by the presence of the enzyme. Instead, where the enzyme acts is the activation energy, changing the energy of that transition from reactant to product, where the molecules are in the process of bonds being made and bonds being broken. And so this is where we get much of the dramatic increase in rates of chemical reactions when enzymes are present, as they dramatically lower the activation energy and facilitate molecules in getting through the reaction pipeline a lot faster than if no enzyme were present.